Ladies and gentlemen, colleagues, friends, and anybody that's tuned in to listen, here we are, you know, still in the midst of the terrible situation that everybody's experiencing. Today, this afternoon, I've got somebody that I've got to know a little bit better than I thought I would when I first met him, and it's been a pleasure. His name's Danny Vranks, and I'm sure if I've pronounced that wrong, Danny, you'll let me know. But Danny is the CEO of Aviarco, which is a ground service engine equipment company. So, Danny, was the pronunciation okay or not?
Well, the exact pronunciation is Vranks.
All right,
but it's not so easy for some people. For some people, it's a bit difficult. Yeah, I know.
All right, Danny Vranks. All right, that's got a good name. It's like a little bit of a film name. Eh? I expect to see you in some sort of mafia film or something with Robert De Niro. What was it? Yeah, Danny, listen. Thanks very, very much for coming on. Really appreciate it, especially in these trying times. Can you just explain to everybody, you know, what do you do and what does your company do?
Yes, of course. Well, Aviarco is a company which is actually refurbishing ground support equipment. So all the equipment which is coming out of operation, which is on a replacement from a handling company or from an airline, we are buying these machines and we bring them to our workshop, and then we're making a full refurbishment on them. We have different levels of refurbishment that we are doing, but mainly it's full refurbishment. And then when the machines are ready, can be on request, or when they are just ready in stock, then we put them on our website, and then they are available for the whole world for either for rental or for direct purchase or whatever the customer needs are. That is basically the total concept of Aviarco.
Okay, very good. And you've got workshops in Amsterdam and also whereabouts in Spain?
In Spain, between Barcelona and Valencia, in a place called Amposta.
Okay, very good. Now, obviously, everybody's talking about it. People can't get away from the problems at the moment, and you know, people are learning how to do things in a different way. How's this whole episode affected your business, Danny?
Well, at the moment, of course, we're squeezing our costs down, and we hope that we can keep our operations going. Right now, we are still running the two workshops, of course, on a low speed. We hope that we can surpass this situation as good as possible. If we don't need to stop the refurbishment work, that would be fantastic. But yeah, if any case of the virus is found in one of my companies, then immediately we need to close down, of course. Yeah.
Okay, so it really is tough for everybody across all industries. And before we go into the specialist areas, I think one of the things that we need to do is to show recognition and respect for all of the people that are dealing with the frontline activities on the health, the hospitals, pharmacies, you know, cleaning, people on transport, looking after the susceptible. It's an incredible thing that they're doing. So I think we need to, you know, just recognize that, and hats off, round of applause to every single person
absolutely.
That's doing it. Absolutely brilliant. And I think, Danny, it's going to make an awful lot of people show an awful lot more respect to some of the services that people took for granted and possibly don't get remunerated to the level that they should. And I certainly hope that's what happens in the future.
No, definitely. It is all putting us with our feet on the ground and make us realize that somehow that the industry is sensitive for such things, not only for terrorism, now it's a health issue.
Yeah,
it was something that was totally unexpected. But absolutely, it is waking us up that the aviation industry is very sensitive to this kind of things.
Yep, sensitive to everything, huh? All natural disasters and man-made disasters, and now this virus. It's incredible. Now, Danny, I've been saying to everybody that I've had on during this week, you know, that everybody's going to have to get used to stop thinking about all our yesterdays, because they're gone. And what we do today, will prepare us for a new normal of tomorrow. So, What are you doing to prepare your business for the new normal?
Well, at the moment, we took the opportunity to review all our processes, all our administration, all the things that we were doing step by step to see that where we can improve, where we can bring our costs down, where we can, in our IT, where we can get a better systems and everything. So the time that we otherwise were missing because of the day-to-day business, there we are taking the opportunity now to do this and to improve it, to get ready for the next the situation, when the situation is going to be resolved, that we can take on directly a lot of work and start working as good and as efficient as possible.
Okay, so Danny, let me ask you: you're still buying stock and still buying equipment from any organization that may either be winding down or being forced to wind down?
Yeah, definitely. If we find some machines which are of our interest, then we just keep on going. Yeah, okay. Buying and selling, and selling will be on hold right now. But if I found some handling companies at the moment who want to have some cash or anything, and they want to sell their machines, yeah, we are interested in buying some more stock right now. Yeah.
Okay, so if anybody wanted to get hold of you, they can do so through your website. Yeah.
Yeah. They can contact me. My contact details are on the website. Yeah.
Okay, very good. Now, this agility, Danny, that people are having to look towards for the future. I mean, I'm no expert, and I think lots of the experts are no experts either, because, you know, they didn't know what was coming, and even with the world's eye on China when it was, you know, things were still slow to respond when it suddenly looked as if it was a surprise to every other country. However, what they've done and the way they've responded and looking after the people of each nation, I think, is also very good. Now,
yeah,
this agility moving forward, and once the government knows that, you know, the trend line or the reference is starting to plateau out and they're able to manage it and control it, then obviously there has to be some releasing of some of these measures that are taken to get people back into some sort of new normal life. Now, when that happens,
yeah,
I think there'll be a real pressure for ramping up of everything, because people will start to appreciate that there's a window of sort of breathing space and retrenching, shall we say, because I definitely believe that this is going to rebound at least once or twice before they either find a vaccine or they get it under control. And I think for all of us here in Europe at the moment, I think the timing with the seasons, I mean, we're lucky that the weather's milder. It's not so depressing with the dark evenings and everything. I think we've been very lucky with that. But I think people are going to have to appreciate, they're going to have to ramp up very quickly, and then they're going to have some plans to contract and slow down in a controlled fashion again, because if this comes back, we're going to have to be prepared a lot quicker and a lot more effectively than we were in the past. Do you see that as a possibility within the business?
Yeah. I think that absolutely that this is going to be an exercise. It's happening now for the first time, but I think for sure in the future we are going to have to live with that and keep this in mind, that this can happen at any time. That if some cases are discovered in your area, that immediately they need to isolate them and to put the whole operations in quarantine, and that, you know, like having a plan ready. Okay, this is how we need to deal with that. We stop our operation, we isolate the situation completely until it is over. And I think how better we have this under control, how smoother it will go, and how better that the people will be prepared for it.
Exactly, Danny. Now, taking things a little bit further, as you know, as if things were starting to come back again, do you see a change in mindset from some of the companies whereby they would have more of a equipment share policy or program at an airport or between a few operators, rather than the way, you know, it has been in the past, where everybody keeps themselves to themselves, and you know, you land at airports and you see an awful lot of equipment that's not being used, and for the untrained eye, they probably think that there's an excessive amount of equipment there. What's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, somehow I think it will open their eyes for some handling companies to see, let's join forces in this kind of situations that we can collaborate and that we can help each other. Somehow I think it will bring up this habit for people shaking hands and say, okay, we better, even if we are competitors in such kind of situations, we help each other out for the best, rather than thinking only about the money, you know. I think that is absolutely something that is happening now. It will bring the people somehow a little bit more together.
Yeah, yeah.
There's a normal reaction. I think it's the same with the war situation somehow. I think it will be a reaction.
Yeah, no, definitely. And Danny, you mentioned earlier about the fact that, you know, you're going to carry on doing the refurbishment and repair work, provided that there's provided that there's enough parts and that the parts are still going to be produced. Will that change your strategy in the future, whereby you'll run a sort of a risk assessment or a sort of artificial intelligence on the numbers of parts that are the most common and should you keep them in stock, etc.?
No, I don't really think so. At the moment, we are just trying to finish the existing orders. And if I'm getting stuck for any reason because of spare parts or anything, because I can never have all the parts in my stock, which is needed for the refurbishment of these machines, because it is some of the parts, they are really parts that you can only find with the manufacturer, so it would be impossible for me to forecast this.
Okay, and are you able to get parts from other pieces of equipment that obviously then would be scrapped, or does it work like that?
Yeah, we need to be a bit more creative at the moment. That maybe I'm taking parts from another machine that I have in stock to complete another one, and so on and so on, but. Yeah, so far so good. I would say if it doesn't take too long, we will survive this in a smooth way, I would say.
Okay, very good. And Danny, you've got a workforce of 22, is that correct?
Yeah, 22 people I have working constantly on the refurbishment side. Yeah,
and they're all still staying. There's I'm trying to work out what the right term is, but. Obviously, you're looking after them in these trying times as well, huh?
Yeah. They're still all healthy.
Thank heavens. That's another thing, Danny. Now, in our industry, you know, the turnover and the attrition levels are so high and getting higher as other industries start to pay more. You know, people don't want to be on the grounds day and night in all weathers and working shift work. And we're going to lose an awful lot of experienced people from the industry if we're not careful. How do you think, you know, the industry should go about making sure that the competency and the training efforts are still in place to a sufficient level?
Then you're talking purely about the ground handling people, right? The ones who are working on the ramp.
Yep.
I think, of course, they're also at the moment they need to put some people on technical unemployment, of course, which is fully understandable.
Yeah.
But I think somehow when everything comes back to normal, if it doesn't take too long, then the guys will not lose their skills. Some of them, they are there for so many years, used to load and to operate the machines and so on. So I don't think that it's going to be too difficult to keep that at the right level, to be honest.
Okay, that's good. Yeah. And what about training, Danny? Are you upskilling your guys so that they've got, you know, cross capability, whereas they were specialists before? Are you doing anything innovative in that area?
Yes. I have a team going around. Actually, they are following my customers and they are going all around the world where it's needed to give a technical training. Even operational training is requested if it is requested. So they are doing the familiarization training for the people to on how to evacuate the machine when it got stuck on an aircraft. Yeah. I have a team of 3-4 people going around constantly when I have my machines delivered and doing this on-site training. Yeah, and in some of the places in Africa, I even have a SLA, service level agreement, for people to go and to come on a regular basis to do these kind of trainings and to support workshop guys to get the repairs done on their machines. Yeah.
Okay,
we're
good.
Doing that as well.
No, that makes a lot of sense. Danny, something we had some guys, they've been on the show once, I think, and they mm-hmm. came back to do a little episode to advise people of their products. The couple of really young, really sharp lads, and the Reacton, and they've got fire suppression equipment. And they're getting more involved in now the aviation industry because they've seen the benefits to, you know, having their systems in tugs and GPUs, etc. But one of the things that they were saying is that when people are purchasing equipment, they go for the base, lowest core price. And then all these other extras are exactly what it says on the box. They're extras and people have to pay for them. Are you, or do you think there'll be a little bit more attention to risk and certain hazards, and people will want to accommodate the best way rather than the most obvious way? Do you think there'll be a little change in mindset?
You mean in the procurement of their ground support equipment?
Yeah. So take, you know, just say if I was buying equipment from you, based on trends and international trends where, you know, you're seeing now a lot on social media, you're seeing, you know, tugs on fire, you're seeing, the passenger transport buses catching fire, you're seeing GPUs on fire. You know, it make me think now, what benefits could I get from insurance premiums if I was more proactive with regards to fire suppression or containment?
I don't know. I heard about it, that it's happening a couple of times in the past now. But I think that is mainly more with new equipment, because so far, me, myself, I never had any cases, and I'm now in second-hand sales of second-hand ground support equipment for 15 years already, and I never had any cases that one of my machines got fired. So what the reason about that is, that is actually some thoughts, yeah. I don't know. I saw it now in the past a couple of times, yeah.
Yeah. And it's like social media is bringing things more to the attention of everybody. So, you know, if there's a lack of preventive maintenance, you know, if there's certain overwork, obviously certain temperatures, etc., you know, certain things can happen. And these lads were explaining to us the difference between a fire extinguisher and fire suppression. And even with a fire extinguisher, when people are taught to use a fire extinguisher, you can't teach them mm-hmm. under pressure of an actual fire. And, you know, video evidence has shown that people tend to put the fire extinguisher all around the core of the fire and not actually at the core of the fire. So it takes a lot longer to put out and a lot more damage is caused. Whereas these fire suppression systems, as soon as there's an indication of a fire, it just completely suppresses it. And
that makes sense.
Yeah, we were so impressed with the product. Maybe I'll give them your details as well, Danny. Who knows? Might be a partnership made in. I was going to say made in heaven, but made in terrible times. So.
No, but that, absolutely, these kind of new technologies, they are if they are on the market and you can avoid such kind of things, that is absolutely making sense. That is like a tracking systems also. It is just to optimize your usage of your machine and to control it and so on. So this is also something, it's not a bad idea. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
And are you guys branching out into that so that you're giving more intelligence with your equipment? So you just mentioned the tracking of equipment and how to best, optimize and, you know, which equipment should be used ahead of other equipment because of the preventive maintenance. because some airports and aviation authorities, they're putting limitations on the age of your equipment on their airports. Yep. So are you looking at introducing things like that?
No, but we have on our rental machines, we also have the tracking system, monitoring when it is huge and when it is used and where it is being used and so on. We have this already in place. But what we are doing now to follow the tendency of the market is to see how we can modify from diesel machines into electrical. That is now something new that we were actually working on before all this crisis came.
Yeah.
Because we were planning on transferring for our customers for in complete packages, like maybe like 10, 15 staircases, transferring these machines from diesel to electric. That was a project that we had going on and where we were checking on the cost of doing these transactions. Yeah, that was something, but all this is now for the time being on hold.
Yeah.
But I was hoping to have my first result in terms of cost and having some prototypes ready in April, actually. That was what we were planning on.
Okay, well, hopefully we better get back to that, because that's good for the environment and the climate especially. Yeah. And so now, talking about that with the batteries and the problems that you can have with batteries. So I'll definitely put these lads in touch with you now. So as that develops, it's a good combination. Now, Danny, what are you going to do differently in tomorrow's crazy new normal, whatever it's going to be? Have you got any ideas? What are you going to do differently to the way you were dealing with things before?
I think it will not change too much, to be honest. I don't think there is anything particular that you can do. It is not that it's going to, of course, it's going to be changing the behavior of the people in terms of protecting themselves and so on, and their way of traveling and securing yourself for this virus and so on. But for us as a company, we make our people aware of what is happening and to keep distance and so on, like what everybody is doing. But beside of that, I always have been just listening to the demand of the market and try to work in this way, you know. And I will do the same thing. I will do the same thing when tomorrow everything is back to normal. We will just carry on doing what we are doing and listening to the demand of the customer and try to be as flexible as possible to fill in their needs. That is my intention.
One of the things, Danny, obviously we've both traveled and I've bumped into you in various different parts of the world. Is your travel outlook gonna? Do you think that'll be the same when it goes back, or are you gonna try and do more with technology and?
No. Because if you need to start thinking like that, then you cannot go and buy groceries anymore as well, because it is everywhere and around every corner you can find somebody who got the coronavirus. So if you need to stop traveling because of that, then on the other hand, I think one of the other, one day all of us are going to have it, if it is strong or not strong, if you have a lot of if you're going to be very sick or not very sick, all of us are going to have this corona one day or the other. So I don't think it is something that you need to get crazy about and say, I'm going to stop traveling, I'm not going to see my customer, I'm going to call them via Skype, because then there is no life anymore.
Okay, that's the way. Yeah, no, I was just curious whether or not you're going to introduce, you know, more regular Zoom or Skype or...
No, I don't think it is the right way to live with this. We just need to be a bit careful that you don't catch it too easy and take the necessary safety precautions for it. But that's it. What else can you do? I mean, like I say, my believing is that everybody is gonna get it sooner or later.
Yeah, and you just need to.
Yeah. Yes, and. They have to get it as well. Yeah. until there is enough of immunity under the people and there is maybe a vaccination in a couple of months for it. And that is how we need to carry on with it.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. Yeah. Well, Danny, listen, it's been a terrible shock to all industries, not just ours. And as you said earlier on in the in the session, our industry is probably a little bit better prepared at dealing with crazy situations like volcano clouds, terrorism, natural disasters, and now something like this. So please God, everybody will find their new normal as quickly as possible. And like I said, even the politicians, you know, whereas mostly people, all they want to do is criticise them. I think on the main, they're doing a good job and they've all responded very, very quickly to the things that are necessary to keep people's minds at ease. So I wish you and all of your staff success and safe passage to the new normal. And I look forward to speaking to you again soon. And as always, Danny, it's a great pleasure.
Thank you, Chris. It was nice talking to you. And I also wish everybody in the industry all the best. And stay safe together with your families. And let's hope that this will pass soon.
Exactly.
Okay.
All right, Danny. All take care. All the best, my friend.
Okay. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.